Good afternoon. Thank you for being here. This afternoon we're going to have the conference is going to be slightly different to this morning's. Basically, we're going to have each group give their own presentations, and then we'll have questions, and then the next group is going to come, and we're going to play them. The first one is Antonis Danos, Nikos Sinos, Yannis Yabanis, Yannis Christidis, and Yannis Kronon. Antonis is sitting next to me. He's an assistant professor at the Cyprus University of Technology, the co-curator downstairs. Those who are here this morning, you probably know him already. And
Thank you. I'm going to be reading this. It was a bit anxious to connect theoretically together four artworks, so I've written it down instead. Usually I'm just talking, you know, out of paper, but let's see how this goes. The other people are present, by the way, the artists of the groups, and they're going to come up here during question time. They're a bit shy now to come right now, so I'll call them as soon as I finish reading. The initial point of our theoretical discussion as a group was my own interest and research in the concept of hybridity, cultural hybridity, that is. The notion of hybridity has been in the center of discourses in cultural anthropology and postcolonialism of an increasingly transnational, globalized economic, political, social, and ultimately cultural contemporary world. The extensive and seemingly easier flow of information and cultural products across the globe, coupled with great numbers of human migration, whether voluntary or not, for either political or especially economic reasons, has led to narratives of hybridization and hybridity to describe an emergent so-called world reality. It is a state of affairs that is also historically traced by most writers to the centuries of colonial expansion by the West, followed by the realities of a post-colonial order, which in essence is more of a state of neo-colonialism, really, rather than a post-environment, in the sense that the previous world order is or would be a thing of the past. As Brent Smith, in an article on three Latin American films from recent years, elaborates, the notion of that hybridity is employed equally by post-colonial theorists interested in the uneven and syncretic cultural exchange between neo-colonizer and neo-colonized, and postmodernists proclaiming the end of the division between high and popular cultural forms. And he adds further down that in its post-colonial intonation, hybridity emphasizes the impossibility of returning to any notion of essential national or cultural identity after the colonial encounter, particularly in the present context of social, economic, and cultural globalization. Now, it seems to me that both in such critical post-colonial theorizing, as much as in what has been criticized as uncritical postmodernist celebration of hybridity, as a balanced and innocuous mixing of cultures, as well as in the related notions of transculturation or an interculturation. Now, what is latent in both approaches to hybridity, it seems to me, is an acceptance of the validity or of the so-called reality of separate, distinct, if not downright pure, cultures, which at some point in time, largely during the centuries of colonization, came into contact, interacted, collided, resulting in new hybrid realities that by their hybrid state call into question the assumed distinct character of each culture. It is my contention, and certainly one that is far from just my own, that throughout human existence, and certainly ever since the first Sumerian and other city-states in the third millennium before Common Era, what we have only recently termed as cultural hybridity, or transculturality, or interculturality, has been the way of the world, really. It has been the actual lived, embodied experience, both on collective, but also on individual level. Notions of separation, of borders, as fixed, largely impermeable lines of uniquely defined cultures, all have been ideological hegemonic constructs in the service of power struggles and conflicts. The way civilizations have been formed, developed, declined, reformed, etc., has been for the most part characterized by those processes that only in our times we have come to theorize as hybrid, as multi, trans, or intercultural, in recognition of the reality of human experience that our contemporary so-called global times have only accentuated. In Renato Rosato's words, hybridity can be understood as the ongoing condition of all human cultures, which contain no zones of purity because they undergo continuous processes of transculturation. Instead of hybridity versus purity, this view suggests that it is hybridity all the way down. From this perspective, one must explain how ideological zones of cultural purity, whether of national culture or ethnic resistance, have been constructed. So in other words, instead of trying to explain hybridity, we should try to explain that theory that art is the opposite of distinct, pure, separate cultures. In other words, both the individual embodied lived reality and the collective cultural experience have overwhelmingly been of a fluid, constantly changing and becoming state of existence. At the same time, a hegemonic project has always existed, one of reinforcing, ideologically and otherwise, a state of separation and of inclusion-exclusion. Divisions, borders, and roadblocks of any kind are, as far as I'm concerned, the most immediate manifestations of this project. Now, the works in the multiple installation that we have set up downstairs, actually is mostly videos on screen and projections, none of them is on at this moment, but you can see it by tomorrow when the opening of the exhibition. So the works in this multiple installation, and here we just see a few stills of all of them, apart from one which is strictly a sound installation, negotiate borders, roadblocks, or any other lines that signify separation and or exclusion, more in the sense of Homi Bhabha's third space, which constitutes, again in the world of Brett Smith, the in-between space of cultural translation and negotiation, where notions of an essential national identity are destroyed and the contingent and indeterminate hybrid identity is constructed. At the same time, these works expose the artificiality of such divisions lines, not only in terms of their hegemonic control-laden ideology vis-à-vis the hybrid nature of the world, but also in engaging with the globalized reality of transborder neoliberal economics and financial multinational domination that either nullifies or enforces, albeit selectively and at will, division lines. One of the works downstairs is Yannis Christidis' sound installation, and at this point I'm going to try to give you a little bit of sound of that. Here we are. Yannis Christidis has created a soundscape composition which uses the existing multidimensional oral ambience in the so-called buffer zone in the old center of Nicosia. It sonically develops in stages, making use of the most important sound marks of the area. Their sound properties, such as rhythm, pitch, timbre, etc., are morphed and evolved throughout the composition in parallel to the exposition of the characteristic and culturally intensive sounds. People talking Greek, Turkish, or English, perhaps at the crossing checkpoints, musical and religious sounds associated with the two so-called ethnic communities in Cyprus, sounds of footsteps, cars. The composition consists of processed recordings that took place mostly in the old center of Nicosia, but also, and interestingly enough, in places in Greece and Turkey. The structure of the information is organized, firstly, by negotiating the nature of the people's situated identity through sound, and secondly, by exposing the fluidity of the borders in such areas and their transcendence and or complete nullification by sound. Moving on to one of the other works, that's Janos Economou's Autumn. Here we have a different kind of transcendence of borders manifesting themselves in this work. This time it materializes from the very forces or forces within the high power quarters that themselves have traditionally benefited from the inscription of divisions, borders and exclusion lines. At the same time, these forces make a mockery of such borders at will by their global new order of economics, which sweeps over countries and peoples, overturning living patterns and micro as well as macro environments, commodifying subjectivities, consolidating control and policies, and policing through national and any other boundaries. Themes such as financial crisis from Iceland to Cyprus, accumulation of virtual wealth, neoliberal impunity of the financial system, art as another means to create virtual wealth, the development bubble, construction boom and bust in Cyprus, mass-produced Mediterranean villas and apartment blocks for easy sales to foreigners and locals, and Mediterranean villas, Mediterranean quotes, of course. In one projection, the camera is traveling frantically around such houses, and it's also using quotes from The Economist on articles dealing with Damien Hirst, you probably know the artist, and his business approach to art. Another projection, it's a dramatic close-up of a drill, symbol of tearing down as much as construction on massive scale. Its aggressive, even phallic and violating image is then juxtaposed in the third projection of a rather pathetic image, almost still, of a dying whale, in a coast in Iceland. The planet is indeed bleeding. And of course, these are stills from the videos. You'll be able to see the videos downstairs. Now, this is indeed the greedy state of the current economic crisis, of the neoliberal economic new order of planned chaos and of ecological disasters. It is a reality that the work of Nikos Sinos, by the title of Strawberry Fields, has set out to so-called reconstruct. And of course, in case you're wondering where the strawberry thing came from, of course, the Strawberry Fields Forever song of Beatles is in his video. But initially, we also were talking about this story that I'm mentioning in the abstract in the program, where I had a different title for all this presentation, actually, of strawberries from the north being sold in the south. And when I was asking the young man, oh, where are these strawberries from? He said, from Derinia. And Derinia, of course, is a crossing point. And to me, interestingly, that phrase of his transformed a crossing point, a division line, into a space of production, a space of production of strawberries in this case, virtual strawberries, you might say, or pseudo strawberries. The strawberry fields, it's a multiple photo stills, in strawberry fields, multiple photo stills compose animated sequences in the manner of cinematic shots. These scenes have been mutated temporarily in a stripy form in order to present 24 different moments of the same time or of the same experience. The visual time, in this sense, is not only the present, but also the immediate past and the immediate future together. Each of the 24 stripes that assemble the picture is by 1 second different than the one next to it. Therefore, each second of watching equals 24 seconds of video. We never know exactly which time we are watching or whether we are looking at pictures or scenes that resemble reality. There are no added visual effects, only the vertical time slicing of the scenes. The sound, which is a sampling of Beatles' Strawberry Fields Forever, hence the title, is subjected to the same mutation. You'll be able to hear it downstairs in the installation. As we watch 24 moments of the same scene, we simultaneously hear 24 moments of the song. It all amounts to an effort to reconstructing an urban, repetitive, psychedelic, if you like, new, virtual, whatever, reality, indeed a more desired reality out of recycled images of our aforementioned gritty present state of economic crisis, of enforced border lines and roadblocks, of nationalistic manifestations of collective identity obsessions, of relentless massive constructions and of ecological disasters. The visual material includes images from a surface coal mine in Western Macedonia and Greece, an ecological disaster, abandoned and ruined villages, huge craters, heavy industrial constructions and power plants. We have scenes from the endless repetition in television programs and news programs of coins dropping on the mint's machinery and the printing of banknotes. It's interesting, every time they talk about the economic crisis that money showed, they keep showing money being printed and printed and printed all the time, you know, the absurdity of the news programs. Scenes from Nicosia border area, abandoned buildings, barbed wires, etc. Scenes from ethnic celebrations in Limassol, Greek flag parades of school children, similar ethnic celebrations and minority demonstrations in Turkey, scenes of massive construction development shot on the Limassol coastline, and images of fireworks. By transgressing borders of visual and oral narration, the work also explores the modes of representation. Representing reality in ways that ultimately representations become, one might say ontologically, reality in themselves, or in other words, they become simulacra. Which brings us to the fourth work in the installation, Yannis Yabanis's Simulacra. Starting off with the Jorge Luis Borges story, in which some of you might know, the cartographers of the empire drew up a map so detailed that it ended up covering the whole size of the territory. Therefore, the map supplanted reality that it was supposed to be mapping. Yabanis created a work where the process of mapping is examined as a code generated reproduction in the mode of Jean Baudrillard, of course, and the map as a simulacrum. On film sequences of the interiors of the current animation and photography labs and the research areas of our department, the multimedia and graphic arts here at the university, stills of the three spaces, same interiors in their previous lives as cabaret, coffee shops, and brothels are superimposed, ending with a mapping of a reality that is no longer present, yet no less real than the building's present actualities. They are all mappings, reproductions, simulacra. The real, not the Lacanian primary real, but reality in the realm of the symbolic, is only possible in a state of becoming, of constant flux and fluidity. Perhaps any fixed space is by default a simulation, thus all scapes, landscapes, soundscapes, any fixed scapes, including borders, divisions, roadblocks, etc., of all kinds, when they are defined as fixed entities, they can only exist as simulacra, no origins, just codes. Thank you very much. If the rest of the gang would like to come up here in case people have questions for your works, please. Yano? Any questions, please, anybody? Or comments or reactions? Or...
I just wanted to make a little comment, only insofar as it sort of set off some thoughts about sort of the way the hybrid, you know, sort of lends itself to a kind of multiculturalism, and unfortunately sort of the recuperation, as I've noticed, for example, where I come from in Australia, where we have many nations or, you know, migrant cultures thrown together, there is a tendency for that mix to become commodified. So, for example, instead of having multiculturalism, you have multiculturalism, like shopping malls, where there are all these, you know, you can have Chinese food, Vietnamese food, you can have Japanese food, you can have all kinds of different foods. And in a sense, it makes people feel like they're participating in a kind of a in a mix of cultures, but in fact it really doesn't do very much other than sell it back to you, you know. as a commodity, unfortunately. I mean, that's part of the relentlessness, I suppose, of capitalism. But yeah, I wonder if you have any thoughts on that.
Actually, yes. To me, multiculturalism is no less hegemonic than when we had center-periphery kind of theories before. I mean, multiculturalism was really the way that the center dealt with the invasion of the periphery. Like, you know, like in the 70s and 80s, when the colonies finally turned around and moved into the center, you know, diasporas, migration, and all that, and England and London is a great example. Then the center was at a loss what to do. Mm. And they came up with this wonderful, almost racist idea of multiculturalism, is that, okay, this is the main body of culture, us. You are all the others. We're going to take you in and we're going to become multi.
Yes.
But really, you're still related to us as periphery to center. Multiculturalism was really center-periphery hegemony in disguise,
yes.
Which is why most of theorizing has definitely gone beyond that into hybridity, transculturation, interculturation, whether it's the critical post-colonial perspective, because we shouldn't forget that there is still an unevenness of power. I mean, we are not really in post-colonial times, we are in neo-colonial times to a great extent. And of course, then you got a bit of postmodern theorizing, like, oh, how lovely the world now is. We're all wonderful, happy hybrids hopping around. We're not quite. But in both cases, we move from the multicultural into the hybrid or the transcultural, the inter, because multiculturalism simply proved itself to be just the way the center was trying to negotiate, what am I going to do with all these others that came in and they want a place under the sun, our sun.
Yes.
So they came up with multiculturalism, and to me that's defined, right? Ideologically that's defined.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I think we're saying the same thing really,
yeah,
in different words.
Yeah. Thank you.
Please, a question to the artists about their works?
Or
maybe to me.
I don't know, it's more a general question, so maybe also kind of repeating what you said, but because one point was that hybridity is kind of like the ongoing state that we're already in it, so it's not like that it just started, but you mentioned that the new things are the new technologies and some kind of acceleration. So all the artworks are dealing like with sound installations and video with these new technologies. So I wanted to kind of ask you what is then the new things, and is it like using new technologies, is it then already referring to this new social phenomena that we have just by using these media? So I was thinking about that point.
Well, the original point about technology is that our world, you know, with the internet, with the communication and all that, has made more obvious the state of hybridity that, as far as I'm concerned, and fortunately some other theories too, has always been really the way of the world. It's just that technological developments in our age have done it more acute and more obvious. What is new about hybridity is that now we theorize about it. So the new parts of theorizing. Now, the use of technological and new media in the works, however, is a different story. I think they're simply speaking, if you like, with today's media, but I think
you're using a media that is already reflecting on that state of hybridity,
just media
itself in some way. So I was thinking maybe also by making that decision to using that media, in which way is it also speaking in all these works?
Well, so. For my part, is that this is the media these guys are usually working in anyway. I mean, that's the kind of artists they are. I mean, that's what they do. But anybody wants to talk about your use of this kind of media, video, sounds, and all that?
Instead, I would repeat the cliché. I didn't choose it. It chose me. It's the one that I feel more comfortable to work with. It wasn't a premeditated decision that this would reflect more accurately what I want to say. Occasionally, I can use this within my medium, which is video, but I felt that it was more appropriate to my personal artistic temperament rather than a theoretical decision. I come from this generation that the media were in front of us and we just chose them. They chose us, I don't know. It's not like the 60s when people were searching for an alternative languages. That's how I see it. But I understand what you're saying about the fast, the way that it works. It really reflects probably more accurately the state of the world that we are in, and probably it can be more critical. The key word here is to be more critical about the situation.
Yeah, but we did it cautiously.
Very different ways of overlay, for example, in old words, like the overlay of soundscapes, images. So I think there are things that are specific for this media and maybe specific for this theme, and I'm still wondering like how this fits together.
In other words, they didn't choose this so-called new media to meet my concerns of hybridity. No, this is the media that they normally work in, and perhaps my theorizing of hybridity was forced by the fact that they are using this media, so perhaps it was the other way around.
It's a good question. I think it would be interesting for the audience here to know a bit more about the process of doing this collaboration. That is, did you curate already existing works?
Oh, no.
Did you have discussions? Did you have any feedback to each other's work?
We began, I just sent them an email saying, look, I want you guys to work towards this project. This is what the theme is, but this is what I'm considering about. I even sent them a couple of theoretical papers that I was kind of dealing with at that time. And then we had, meetings like over souvlaki and beers and pizzas, and we started talking from the supplying to the reticulas, and we started working through that, and ideas started coming up. At some point, each was going their own separate ways, producing some work, and then getting together again, and started discussing again what everybody's doing, everybody kind of intervening theoretically into each other's work. So, yeah, it was truly a kind of a
group thread between the four works.
I would like to think so. At the same time, these are works that they start autonomously, even though I was talking about a multi-part installation, but they start autonomously, they could be in any other different framework.
I think at some point we're going to work as a group and even have a common name, like people do sometimes, and then we decided that it was not feasible because we had different directions. But we had physical meetings like over souvlaki and beer, but then we had conversations through the emails and so on. So although there is no direct influence, I think we're influencing each other in different ways. Because we're sending each other our work and our research.
And getting feedback. Of course, we're going to call ourselves the Gorilla Girls, but their name is taken. So we said, okay, we give up on that idea. In a way, I was kind of the kind of the theoretical in between, but the discussions kept going back and forth, but at the same time they were also working on their own and autonomously. So it was a mixture of all these processes. But everything was started and was done just for this occasion.